Welcome, everyone. My name is John Hyde. Thank you very much for joining us today. I am the Assistant Director of Career Development and Alumni Relations for the Data Science Institute here at Columbia. Thank you again for being with us. Today's seminar is on iCubed, which stands for the Institute, Industry, and Innovation. These are seminars connected to our industry affiliates and offered to our affiliates, which we put out to our students and the larger Columbia community to explore topics at the forefront of industry. We invite data scientists, engineers, and researchers from our affiliates to give a talk about recent projects or case study. During these educational events, we encourage attendees to ask questions via the chat and Q&A, and we'd appreciate that again this evening. Today, we have a data scientist from Bloomberg, and we have speaking this evening is Daniel Preotiuc-Pietro. And today's talk will be an unapplied named entity recognition at Bloomberg. And for that, we will hand it off. We thank you for joining us and look forward to your questions in the Q&A. This is, for your information, being recorded. So Daniel, over to you. Thank you.
Okay, great. So thank you very much for the introduction. So my name is Daniel. I'm a senior research scientist and a team lead at Bloomberg in the Bloomberg AI group, where I lead the core NLP team. So today I'm going to talk about applied named entity recognition at Bloomberg. But before I do that, I wanted to start by talking a bit about the Bloomberg Terminal. The Bloomberg Terminal is the main product of Bloomberg. So the Bloomberg Terminal is a software that delivers a diverse array of information, news, and analytics to facilitate financial decision-making. And as you may see here, the terminal is built up of many different applications, which we call functions. So the terminal is really around a few thousand different products that operate mostly independently. And the terminal delivers real-time news, market data like stock prices, orders, trades, and messaging. It delivers analytics, and is basically a huge real-time information aggregator that lets our subscribers take action related to their financial interests. This is a bit about the clients of the Bloomberg Terminal. Most importantly, it's used by financial professionals, basically anyone who is interested in the global capital markets. And an important thing is that stock markets aren't the only places. What I want to highlight is stock markets aren't the only places to buy or sell instruments. And customers of Bloomberg's are not only traders, but really the entire ecosystem of finance, ranging from investment banks and hedge funds, governments, regulators, to national or central banks. And all these financial actors need to have information in order to drive their decision-making. And separately, I should say, we also deliver functionality for individuals as well as enterprise functionality for firms in forms of data streams and data feeds and so on. And here is an image about how various departments in Bloomberg, such as management, engineering, global data, product, we are all aligned and work together to generate value by bringing financial data to markets and to our clients. So if you heard about Bloomberg, most people will likely know Bloomberg mainly because of our news and TV services. But as you saw, the Bloomberg's main business is the terminal. And because of this, Bloomberg is primarily a technology company founded 40 years ago. Our strength and focus are data analytics and community tools. We have around 20,000 employees in over 150 offices around the globe, out of which 2,700 are journalists. But actually, the largest group are software engineers. So we're currently over 6,500 software engineers, including more than 200 engineers and data scientists working on AI-related related problems. And we pride ourselves with an increased use and contributions to open source software and increased presence in academic research through publications, workshops, and various funding that that we give for fellowships or for academia. So as I mentioned, I'm part of the Bloomberg AI group. Our group develops software models and data resources to solve foundational problems in machine learning, information retrieval, natural language processing, and related areas. This slide shows how the six different groups in AI fit into the Bloomberg's business model. So on the left here, you see basically all the different sources of data that we ingest and extract. In the middle, basically, we group teams in Bloomberg generate insights and analysis, connect the dots between different data sets. And then we have other teams that work on discovery and data access for our users in order to serve results, either query-based or without a query. So the groups in AI are editorial, which helps our journalists provide information to the clients via news, and we help them with their discovery process and editing process. In terms of teams that work more into generating insight and analysis, we have teams that work on finance, so kind of core machine learning, time series types of problems. Teams in communications that help enhance our communication platform that facilitates trading, for example, via our messaging services. And news and research, which facilitates access to news and equity research data. And on the right side, we have the discovery and search groups, which basically deal with things like search, autocomplete, and basically making the information more discoverable and available to the users. And at the bottom, we have the AI platforms group, and basically this group, which my team is part of, help power all the different AI applications at Bloomberg. So the most important role of data in finance, the most important aspect that Bloomberg has is access to data, and data is the backbone of capital markets. And historically, this has been in the form of market data, such as quotes, trades, and so on. And this is what we call structured data. But more and more recently, we have the finance sector is interested in alternative data and non-traditional factors such as news, for example, for signals such as sentiment analysis and volume of discussions. Social media, such as Twitter, again, for deriving similar insights, or even more going beyond even to additional data such as footfall traffic in malls, for example. So our goal is to extract and deliver financial signal from this noisy, complex, and tangentially related data sets. And as part of this, one of the main things that we're interested in are identifying named entities. So most of the financial data is actually in unstructured format, and it's estimated to be around 80%. And the ability to automatically identify named entities is essential to understanding this content. And by content, I mean content such as filings, like regulatory filings, tweets, news stories, analyst reports, press releases, chats, emails, client feedback, and so on. So, and in terms for understanding all of this unstructured content, identifying named entities is pretty essential because by named entities, I refer to people or companies or indices and so on. So the regular approach that we use for this is kind of like a pipe for entity detection is kind of like a pipelined approach, kind of classic of NLP tasks, which consists of three steps in our case. The first step is the entity recognition step. So for this step, basically we start with a document here. So this is an example of tweet that reads Amazon suspends top entertainment chief price in wake of harassment claim. This is a cash tag referring to the Amazon stock ticker and dash Hollywood reporter who is reporting the story. So the goal of the named entity recognition step is to identify the named entities in the text, their offsets basically, and their types, and whereby types in this example we have organization, person, and ticker. So once we do this, we go to the entity disambiguation or entity linking stage, and this stage the goal of this stage is to associate named entity mentions in a text their unique identifier in a knowledge base. So in our case, the ideal output of the step would be to take the input, the output from the entity recognition stage and assign unique identifiers to each mesh. So in this case, Amazon and AMZN, they would link to the same identifier. Price would link to this person ID. And Hollywood Reporter, for example, it may be the case that we don't have an identifier for the company. So that's also like a valid output. And the knowledge base we use here for most of this task is the Bloomberg Knowledge Graph. So the Bloomberg Knowledge Graph contains around 4 million companies, for example. It basically contains every company that is traded, plus other companies like government entities or private companies. And that's an order of magnitude higher than, for example, what you would find in Wikipedia or like a public, which is the largest public knowledge base. And finally, we have another step that operates on the output of the entity detection step, which is called named entity salience. So this, the goal of this step is to quantify how central is each explicitly mentioned named entity to the text. So we use this mostly for filtering or for allowing users to be able to search just for in use, for example, just for the companies that play an active role in that document. So in this case, Amazon and Price are key actors. So we would score them as being very salient to the document. But for example, Hollywood Reporter, we would score that lower because the story is not really about Hollywood Reporter. They just reported it. And the main actors are, in this case, are Amazon and Price. So as you can imagine, there's a lot of applications for entity recognition at Bloomberg. I'm going to try to list a few of these here. So this is used for aiding accessibility for news and financial documents. It's used by editors who can tag and identify entities as at the time that they are producing the story. It's used in search and autocomplete. It's used in various ETL pipelines that we have when we, for example, when we collect or bring in new data to our system, we ingest it. And one of the main things we're looking for that data is to link it to other parts of the Bloomberg ecosystem. And that usually involves identifying companies, their identifier, and then link that forward. And also for enhancing client communication. So for example, if two people are discussing about a company or a specific bond, we want to be able to link to that and provide them additional context or additional information for their discussion. So also I should mention that entity detection is used either directly or as part of for example, the communications case that I mentioned, or as part of a pipeline of models. So for example, we would use entity detection as a first step or a middle step before doing, for example, sentiment analysis or any other trend analysis. So these are a few examples of some functions that we have on the terminal. So here I show a screen from our trend function. So this shows news trends. So for example, this shows what are the most talked about companies on social media during, I think, 8-hour window across the world. So you can see here is basically people can get, investors can get a high level view of what companies are most talked about, and then look at, for example, their price change, volume, and then they can search for actual content that is behind that is behind the statistics. And of course, they can adjust for time window, for region of the world, positive, negative sentiment, for example, rather than just volume and so on. So this, for example, is a more in-depth look at how sentiment on a company would look like. Again, this is for social media and this is related to Tesla. So every bar here basically shows the volume of content about this particular ticker on a given day. At the bottom, we show positive, negative sentiment and overlaid, we can have, for example, the stock price, the closing price on that day and so on. We can also use entity recognition directly for setting company alerts that are used by clients. So for example, you can imagine a client having a large portfolio consisting of hundreds of companies. They, for example, they can set alerts when, for example, the volume of content for that company over is over a certain threshold that they can configure. And actually, probably I can stop here and take some questions about the overall motivation, because I'm going to go in a bit in more detail. I see one question about how do we calculate the centrality of an entity in a piece of text. So we have a model. I'm not going to talk about this because I'm mostly going to focus on the first stage of the pipeline, which is named entity recognition. But at high level, we're doing this with annotations. So we build a machine learning model based on annotations. And the way we define this, actually, it's like anchored in some past research, is basically we ask people to judge independently, each entity at a time independently, just given the target entity and target document, how much the document is about that entity. And we have several levels that we ask people to categorize that target entity. Okay, any other question?
So we have a question that came into the portal saying how AI platform powers various AI applications.
Okay, I think my let me know if I didn't interpret this the question correctly. So I think the teams in AI platforms basically provide the infrastructure for various applications. So for example, my team provides the core NLP library that various other teams use to build their applications. So we build like basically foundational tools. You can think of like, you know, our version of Stanford and core NLP, for example, but kind of tailored to our data and to our use cases. Another component of that would be basically our data infrastructure, because of course, to build any application, we need access to data and to access to annotated data. So we have tools to be able to collect or have easy access and permission access to various data sets, and also to be able to collect annotations for data sets, and also the compute infrastructure that we have for running experiments and deploying our models. Plus some generic tools like hyperparameter tuning and so on. I hope I answered your question.
Great. I think it does.
Yeah, if anyone has a follow-up question, just send it in there. So someone, perhaps a follow-up. Yes, a follow-up question saying, so there is a lot of data standardization?
Yes, if I interpret that correctly, yes. So yeah, we have basically like a common interface in which we access various data that we need for building our models. Okay, so
it seems like there may be one more question in the regular chat box.
Yeah, so latency, I'll get to that. I'll get to that later. Okay, so actually it's part of the challenges. So in general, the financial domain and our and Bloomberg's business model provides several challenges to the traditional setup that is being used in academia for NER models. So first we have to deal with a huge variety of document types or genres, from news aggregated from hundreds of sources, including social media, to financial documents, including equity research, transcripts, or company filings. Our requirements actually vary based on the use case, with some workflows requiring high precision to avoid false positives if we're doing straight to processing, and others requiring high recall in the human in the loop and data acquisition pipelines, for example. So different usage setups also exist, whether the models are used for news tagging, for search, or in editing. And we also have to identify financial entity types beyond the classic text set, that's present in regular NER datasets. So this can include products, indices, ETFs, and so on. And finally, our models are sometimes subject to strict latency constraints, as downstream users of the data value the speed in which breaking stories are published, and we have access to process hundreds of thousands of stories daily. So, and we consider all of these as basically opportunities for us to do research in this area and also contribute to academia and to our understanding of these problems. So I would like to, for the rest of the talk, I would like to highlight a few research threads that we've been doing in our group. I'll go into more detail on two of them, and two of them I'll give more of a high level overview. So the first thing I wanted to talk about is a study on temporal drift, and it's published by me and our former intern at ACL last year. You have a link to the paper and video in the slides that I will share. So the motivation of this work is that natural language data evolves over time as a result of changes in languages or changes in the information that's being discussed in the text. And as you probably know from your data science projects, most models are usually trained and evaluated on random splits of the data that are available at model building time. However, the models are often used to make predictions on data posted that is posted at a future time date. So this setup makes the model susceptible to temporal data drift, leading to lower performance on future data as compared to what we would see in the test set. So taking temporal information into account when training the model may lead to getting a better performance. So the research questions that we wanted to study in this paper was to first evaluate whether and how temporal drifting data affects performance of the models. And next, we wanted to investigate how the temporal information available at training time could actually be used in modeling to improve performance on data from a future time period. And our case study is the task of named entity recognition, NER, on English Twitter data. And we think this is an ideal setup because the tweets already have readily accessible timestamp information. Users on social media post about current events, which are likely to include named entities that change over time, and also reflects change in languages faster than perhaps in other sources of data. When we started looking at this, we saw that existing datasets for named entity recognition on tweets do not have sufficient temporal diversity to help answer our research questions. So because the tweets are usually collected within a limited time frame, making them unsuitable for our experiment. So one particular exception was the broad Twitter corpus, which was released in 2016. Even with this, we have the corpus mentioned that it was collected between 2009 and 2014. However, if you look at the graph, this is the green bars here. You'll see that the tweets are unevenly distributed and majority of them come from just 2 years, 2012 and 2014. And fewer than 300 tweets come from all the other years. So for this reason, we created a new collection of tweets and a new dataset annotated with named entities that is temporally diverse. We have 12,000 tweets in total, with 2,000 tweets from each year between 2014 and 2019. And the tweets were sampled to be representative of multiple locations and multiple domains. And because of that, we follow basically the same strategy as the broad Twitter corpus that's detailed there. So for all our experiments, we use basic, because our goal was to study the drift and not study various modeling techniques. So we used the BILE-STM CRF model there. At that time, it was the kind of standard state-of-the-art approach for the problem. And to represent the input text, we used the character and word embeddings. We used the BILE-STM to encode input text, and we used the CRF to make a globally normalized prediction. The word embeddings, we tried two flavors of word embeddings. First, just kind of the static word embeddings using GloVe. And we also used Flare, which are contextual string embeddings. all of them were trained on data before 2014. And how we split the data for our experiment was basically most of the time we used the 2014-2018 tweets for training, and for validation and test, we created random splits on the latest data that we had, which was 2019. So we first evaluate whether temporal drift in the training data affects the named entity recognition performance on the tweets from the year 2019. So basically we train models on the data from each year in the training set individually. And each model we know is trained on the same number of instances. So the data size is not a factor here. So basically we show the F1 score on the test set. We observe that using training data temporally closer to the target results in a better F1 score with both glove and flat embeddings, which demonstrates that temporal evolution of text data impacts the prediction ability of the NER model. Secondly, we wanted to study how the number of training instances and their temporal distribution affects the model performance. So we first train models on random samples from all the years in our training set. So that is 2014 to 2018. And then we compare the random sampling strategy with the temporal sampling strategy, where we start with 2000 tweets from 2014 as training data and cumulatively adding tweets from subsequent years, as you would do, for example, if you have like a model that constantly collects data and adds it to training. So we see that, as expected, first of all, the larger the training data size, the better the performance is. But we also see the performance on the temporal sampling is lower than that in the random sampling, even though the training data size is the same. So if I were to choose 2000 tweets randomly from the 5 years, I would have better performance than just picking the ones that were furthest apart from our test set. So this observation strengthens basically our hypothesis that the temporal distribution of the training data will play a role when designing and training model architectures. So the next thing we did was we did some analysis and analyzed the tweets in our data set to see, maybe to gain some insight into why the model would be affected by the temporal distribution. So one of the potential reasons we thought about is the overlap of entity mentions between training and test, which should be higher if the data is from consecutive time periods. So basically the figures here indicate that lexical overlap of named entity mention increases from the tweets from the years that are temporal closer to the data, both overall and then type-wise, so person, organization, and location, with some differences between the types that are more noticeable here. Then we also saw whether just the surface form overlap is the only factor for improved performance. So the graph here shows the model's recall over named entity mentions that aren't seen in the trained data for models on each year individually. So the unseen mention recall increases as we move temporally closer to the target year 2019, and that means the model is potentially able to learn more relevant context from the training data of temporary close years, perhaps due to changes in language use over time. And finally, we also tried some simple approaches to see how we can actually model temporal information. So the baseline model here, so the baseline here is the standard BIAS-TM CRF architecture that doesn't use temporal information. And our analysis showed that that data that's closer to the target is most useful in terms of performance. So we repeatedly tuned the model on the chronological sequence of years, so kind of using a curriculum learning approach. So we first trained on 2014 data and so on up to 2018. However, this actually doesn't work as well and leads to an overall 2-point reduction in F1 score. Then we tried temporally fine-tuning the data. So that is, we train the model on the data from all years, and then we just train it again, just using 2018 data, which is closest. And actually that gives a consistent improvement of around 1 point. Then we tried some methods based on instance weighting So basically in training, we increased the weights that using various strategies, this was just one of them. However, we didn't find consistent improvements by doing this, by doing like instance weighting. And then we also tried another model where we were trying to predict the year a tweet was posted at training time using a multitask learning approach. So having that as an auxiliary task, we found that gave like marginal gains to our approach. So the takeaways from this work are that temporal information is useful and can be leveraged in model training to some extent. Our work shows that the usual setup of just combining all annotated data and disregarding the temporal information while training the models is not optimal. And in this case study on NER with Twitter data, we show that training on data from closer time period to the target leads to better performance. And we propose some simple methods to leverage temporal information. And our dataset is available publicly if anyone wants to do additional studies. And there were quite a few recently on this. So that concludes this paper. I'll double check the questions. Okay, so I see one was, I think I answered it during the presentation, and I think the last one, what's the difference in training model on data from all years and fine tune the model in year 2018? So train on data from all years is basically just training, just randomly shuffling the data and training on it. And then fine tune model in year 2018 is basically doing the same first step. And then at the end, just extracting the 2018 data and continuing training the model with it. So what's the root cause? I guess that's a good question, and I don't think we have like a definite answer, but it's a mix of both, basically. Both new entities emerge and language changes, and there's no like easy way to get to this. And actually there have been a few follow-up papers like very recently that look into more detail about why this happened, but the answer is usually a mix of both. How do we pick the model? We pick the one with a better performance on the test data. Okay, so next I'm going to present our work on multi-domain modeling. This was also presented at ACL 2020, and this work was done by me and two of my colleagues, Jing and Mayank. So the motivation for this work is NER currently achieves a very high performance when trained on enough data of the same genre. So here you have the classic NER Connell 2003 dataset. This is the most widely used dataset. And recent state-of-the-art approaches achieve an F score of 80 just using a biased TMCRF architecture with contextual word embeddings. And actually this since we have this can you hear me? Can someone confirm?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, something happened to my audio. Since we basically created the slide, actually this performance can be pushed, is shown to be able to be pushed up to 93, 94 F1 on this data set. However, these models fail to carry a similar performance on the same task, but using data from other genres. So we illustrate this in the figure by just taking this model that was trained on this Connell dataset and evaluating it on seven other datasets from other domains. This is Twitter, and these are on-to-node subsets. Actually, some of these like are communications, but some of them should theoretically be very similar to the one, to the Connell one. So this is, for example, Newswire, and this is broadcast news, and Connell dataset is actually made up of news stories from Reuters. So even if seemingly the data is of a similar source, we still see an over 10-point degradation in the quality of the model. So ideally, in real-world applications, we would want to have a single model that can accurately tag a variety of documents. So the problem of adapting types to document not seen in training is known as domain adaptation, and traditionally domain adaptation has been researched in a setup where the goal was to improve predictions on a target domain where data is scarce or unavailable by using data from a single source domain where data was available. And we refer to this as single source, single target domain adaptation. Here a single model will be able to aim to leverage in our setup, a single model will aim to leverage data from multiple source domains to improve overall performance over multiple target domains. And this transition from single source, single target methods to multiple target domains is not trivial or hasn't been widely studied. And why we would want to do this, there's actually multiple benefits to being able to have a single domain that can tag multiple domains accurately. First of all, it will be able to leverage commonalities across multiple data sets and improve performance across all domains. Additionally, it can identify information specific to a single domain that it can exploit only for that type of data. And this type of information would allow such a model to generalize better to data from other domains, potentially unseen in training. And the single model would also provide practical benefits because it would simplify model maintenance compared to managing multiple models, maybe one for each data set, which would be, you know, a trivial approach for solving this problem. So the key contribution of the paper, at least in the way we view it, is the study of this problem setup, which we call multi-domain NER. So we introduced three different experimental setups for this problem, all of them which are used at inference time. The first setup involves testing over multiple domains. At inference time, the domain-specific label is available to the model, and this corresponds to the use case where the user of the system provides data from a domain used in training and is also aware of the domain label of the data. So for example, when feeding news articles from a known source to the model, and you're also the one who also designed the model, so you know what information to provide to the model. The second setup involves testing over multiple domains, but the domain-specific document label is not provided at inference time. So this corresponds to the situation where the user is aware of the domains used in training, but it's not aware of the genre of the data that he's providing. So for example, this could be a user that, you know, uses the NER system in an opaque way, for example. The third setup measures the performance on genres which we haven't seen in training at all. And this is the goal here is to measure the ability of the model to generalize to this data. And this matches the use case where a user provides data from a new type of document that we have unseen in training or he's completely unaware of what happened in that step. So in order to do our experiments, we use the following collection of data sets. We use this Connell 2003 standard data set of news articles. We use 22,000 tweets. Actually from the previous paper, I mentioned we increased that data set to cover 2009 to 2019, actually. And finally, we use the Ontonauts data set. That's a data set that has six different genre types, newswire, broadcast news, magazines, broadcast conversations, telephone conversations, and web data. And additionally, we have four proprietary data sets, which we tested on, that we labeled as zero-shot domains that we're going to use to test on the third setup. And actually, just these are on the right, you will see some summary statistics. Basically, this shows just the density in terms of like entities per token ratio in the data sets. And you can see these are very, very different in terms of size and density. Again, because the base architecture that we use in our experiment is the same BILE-STM CRF approach using a combination of glove and fast text embeddings with also like a character LSTM that's randomly initialized. And we experiment with two types of models for our baseline. First, I think kind of the natural baseline would be training independent models, one for each domain, which we'll call in domain for the rest of the, for the rest of the discussion. So an additional model that we have made in order to be able to use this approach on the second setup, where the users can provide the label of their document, the domain label of their document, is we also train a domain classifier that basically takes an input and classifies it to one of the known domains in training, and then just assigns that label and passes and gives it to the writing domain classifier. The drawbacks we imagine for this would be it leads to a poor generalization, and of course it requires additional overhead to add new genres to train a new model and so on. The other baseline approach is a pooled model, basically, which basically naively just combines all the data sets that are available and trains like a single model over all of them. And we have a few variations of these of the pooled domain model. We have this init strategy, which initializes weights from the learned domain and fine tunes on the new domain over multiple iterations. All of these basically are inspired by past research in domain adaptation. We have another one which uses the gradient reversal there, basically. And the aim of this model is basically to create a model that tries to have an auxiliary task as a domain discrimination task, and which tries to basically confuse the model into learning like general information rather than domain specific information. And the last model uses the domain information explicitly by passing through a domain embedding and then concatenating this with the word embeddings. The general drawbacks for this type of approach is that this approach mostly discards genre specific information, which we think is going to be very useful to model under certain circumstances. So this is the architecture that we propose to solve this problem. Basically, we add three components to the base architecture, which I'm going to discuss one by one. First, we add domain shared and private CRFs. So basically what we do is for each domain, we create a private CRF. So this is based on like kind of the generic strategy in domain adaptation, which builds shared and private components. So the idea of the shared components is to model generic information that's common across all the different domains, and for the private to model specific information that's only useful for one domain and may confuse the model on other if used on other domains. So we do this, we create separate CRFs for each domain, and also shared CRF at the end. The other component that we do is we have between the BILE-STM and the CRF, we have linear layers. So a linear neural network. So we create separate layers also for shared and private information. And at the end, we also train this model with an auxiliary task of domain classification. So basically the model uses the outcome of the BILE-STM encoder, uses those embeddings to also try to predict the domain in which a data set is. And we believe that this helps guide the model learn better information in the shared and private layers. So now we try to combine the performance of the proposed method with the baseline approaches in the three setups. So on the left, we have the experimental setup where we assume the genre of test data has been seen in training and the domain label is provided at inference time. So when we compare this with our baselines, which is the in domain and the pool domain, we see that we get all of these scores, by the way, are macro F1. So the way we compute them is basically compute F1 on each domain, and then we average them. So, you know, if there's more data in one domain, that doesn't impact the metric. So that's why we use macro F1. So we get an overall macro F1 of over 3 F1 improvement over just the in-domain approach, so train individual classifiers, and over 2 points or around 2 points better than just merging all the data together. In the second experimental setup, here we assume that the user provides data that from a domain that has been seen in training, but doesn't provide the label, the explicit label of it. So here we have multiple baselines. Here the in-domain baseline also needs to use a domain classifier in order to identify which of the individual models it should route that document to. And again, using our model multi-domain shared private with auxiliary classifier, we're able to get around two F1 macro F1 improvement over the over this approach. And the pool domain actually performs similarly in this setup. And the third setup is the zero-shot domain, basically, where we test on data that from domains that have not been seen in training at all. And actually here is where we see the biggest gain for our model, because our model has been trained with explicit goal of trying to generalize better or try to find like shared information across all the different domains. So we can see that our model is able to extract this information much better, for example, than a pool domain over four macro F1 improvement. And in our paper, of course, we have a lot of other analysis. I just want to highlight this ablation study that we had. So this is basically the base model, and this is on zero shot, and this is the one that contains all the three improvements. And actually we see, we ablate all the different, we remove basically each of the three components that we add, and we actually see that each of them contributes and more or less around the same around the same amount of performance to the ultimate improvement of the model. So just adding the CRFs improves by 2.7, then also adding the linear layers improves a further 0.4, and then adding the auxiliary task over adds another 1.5. Any of them is missing, everything will basically drop by 1 or 2 points, as far as I remember. So the takeaway here is mostly about the experimental setup that we propose. So we propose three real-world scenarios for doing entity recognition at scale. And we also propose the simple model, a relatively simple extension of the model using kind of known techniques from domain adaptation to build a very robust NER model that again gets up to plus five F1 compared to baseline approaches. So with that, I can take maybe a few questions if there are.
Anyone out there have any questions? Taylor, do we want to go live questions? Or
okay. If there are no pressing questions, then I can finish the presentation. I just have like around 4 or 5 minutes of content.
Okay, sure. Yeah.
So yeah, I just want to briefly touch upon two research directions in our group. First, we had this paper in 2019, published by Ravni, Chense, Keti, Anjo, and Yi, named Semi-Markov Structured Support Vector Machine Model for High Precision Named Entity Recognition. The task here is high precision NER, where we're focusing on a specific type, in this case, to identify organization names with a high performance. And this actually has many real world applications, finance and also biomedical. And here, an example here of this comes from an event that happened in 2017. There's others. So here, Bill O'Reilly, for example, was a popular Fox News TV host, and there were several allegations of sexual harassment against him. And in the end, Fox News decided to fire O'Reilly, and people on Twitter reacted positively to this news. And actually this led so O'Reilly was a person, but it's actually led to an increase in the stock price of O'Reilly Auto Parts stock for people probably doing automatic trading for systems that were probably doing automatic trading and mislabeling a person for an organization and linking it incorrect in this case. So here you can actually see the price change over that day. The objective here was to train models that have high precision on one type at the expense of other types. So the method was a semi-Markov structured SVM model. And the main baseline here was actually a model that just uses thresholding on the output. So you can find more details about this in our paper. And finally, I briefly wanted to mention a recent paper we published this year, me, Ravnita, and Chense. It's named Identifying Named Entities as They Are Typed. So typically, NER is applied on complete sentences. For example, in the given sentence, New York Rangers is recognized an organization. But this is not particularly well suited for applications where text is processed in real time as it's being entered, where we want to have a prediction on New York Rangers immediately as the entity was typed, for example, in journalist setup or where a journalist is typing this, or for example, in closed captioning when someone is speaking, and we immediately want to identify entities. So actually our experimental setup, the main contribution again is the experimental setup here. And basically what the setup is, instead of doing prediction on the full sentence, we're basically doing predictions on each partial sequence. So basically after each token, and then we are basically taking the output of each token and computing basically the output. But that also doesn't mean, for example, in New York, New York is location, the model may identify it as location, which is wrong in this case, because the model doesn't know that Rangers is going to come up next. So probably the model will think that, you know, New York should be a location. So in this case where the location is mislabeled, maybe the model can correct itself and identify New York Rangers organization, but it can't change past predictions, but it can review it, basically its internal state of the model, and be able then to predict future entities better. As I mentioned, some applications here would be instant entity suggestion for editors, speech to text entity tagging, and other downstream applications as autocorrection, autocomplete, or maybe simultaneous machine translation. All of which need to be aware of entities. So we start basically again from the same baseline architecture, similar to the one used in the previous papers, by STM encoder with CRF using glove word embeddings, character embeddings, and contextual flare embeddings. And here in this case, the baseline, or actually in this case, the target for us is a model trained on full sentences, but tested. And I should say the other baseline should be the same model, but tested on the edge type setting. So this is in blue. This is a model trained regularly on full sentences that does predictions on token by token. And on yellow basically is the upper bound, which is basically the model that has access to the full sentence and just predicts everything based on that. So we propose a few adaptations based on this. We studied this across three different languages, and we are able to bridge almost half of the gap of naively applying the approach trained on full sentences. We are able to bridge almost half the gap between that and an Oracle setup where we have access to the whole sentence. And details for this are in the paper. So I guess the general takeaways of my presentation. First of all, I hope I managed to convince you and show to you that entity recognition and entity detection is central to finance applications. And of very important practical utility. And also I hope I convinced you that Bloomberg provides unique challenges and opportunities that can lead to new research and applications. And these challenges usually stem from the variety of use cases and requirements that we have, and also the variety of data sources we have to deal with, and usually, which are usually also subject to latency constraints. So that wraps up the talk. Thank you very much for everyone for attending the presentation.
Daniel, many thanks. Let me just see. We've got a few minutes Don't know if we have anybody else out there that would like to ask a live question. We're kind of dwindling down some names. I know we have class tonight for some of our students, so they might be moving on to getting to that. Any thoughts, any questions out there from anyone?
So I have, Wilmer mentioned again the question of how do we measure centrality importance of an entity in a sentence? So we basically, we train a model based on annotated data. And use the annotator can choose. We define various levels. In our case, we have four different levels, from the entity being like essential to understanding the story. Basically, if the entity is not present, the story doesn't make any sense. To basically, if we remove the entity, basically the story flow is not much affected, or basically this provides just a detail over it. And then for modeling, it's basically like a targeted prediction, where we have like a target and a context. So you can think of it as it's modeling with similar techniques as aspect-based sentiment analysis or target-based sentiment analysis.
Great. It does look like we have one more question. It says, looks like the last model works well in all experiment setting. What's the intuition why that's the case?
I'm assuming that refers to the multi-domain paper. So the intuition there is basically that what I mentioned towards the start of the presentation is each domain will have basically its own giveaways for identifying entities. So you can imagine that in news, articles capitalization is a strong feature for where entities are. While in Twitter, for example, probably that's not a good feature at all, because people type in all caps or type in mixed caps or don't use capitalization at all, for example. So a model that, you know, that is trained just on news will make mistakes just purely because it's over relying on that feature. So basically, though, that's why modeling individual data sets is important, but also identifying the commonalities across multiple data, because we know, you know, having access to more data and more diverse data makes for a better model. Just being able to leverage those is going to be better. So that's why we try to model with the private network, where basically we try to figure out, we try basically to lead the model to learn basically the giveaways for each domain. And then for the shared model, for the shared component, basically, we try to guide the model to learn kind of general things about what context, around what context, for example, entities usually appear in. And when we train the model with data from one domain, we basically update both its private component, so basically the path that includes all the private parameters for that model, and also the shared component. So the shared component is updated by all the data, and the private is just updated by the data from its own domain.
Coming in furiously now, fast and furious.
When would you do clustering first before NER? Clustering. I'm not sure where the clustering comes from, but basically, in training, we know the domain, basically, right? So we know which data comes from which domain, so we don't need the clustering. But actually, we have like an interesting finding in our paper regarding Oracle models. We found, basically what we did is we trained six different or eight different models for our paper. So those are individual NER models. So for the in-domain setup, we basically picked the model that the data was belonging to. But actually, then we also did this Oracle setup where we basically took the output from all eight individual models and just literally picked whatever was the best one, knowing the real output, and actually performed like 10 points better than what we did. There's definitely room to be more room for an L for gains. And that also, I think, shows that you know, the in-domain model is maybe not the best one for each dataset, but it's impossible basically to figure out which one is going to perform better because I don't know.
I think that seems to have wrapped things there, Daniel. So many thanks. Sure. But Daniel, thank you. Anything else you'd like to add?
No, just thank you very much for attending, and I hope this was interesting.
Very useful.
If you have any follow-ups, then please feel free to email me directly or check the papers for more details.
I haven't seen the Bloomberg terminal that close up for a long time, so it is really interesting to see what gets picked up and to see that the O'Reilly shares had moved the way they did was pretty interesting. So
yeah,
very cool for a layperson, not a data scientist, but anyway.
Yeah, we have several of these like anecdotes.
I'm sure there's some great ones that must come in on a regular basis, depending on what happens. So anyway, all right. Well, listen, thank you so much for your time. All right, Daniel, be well.